Disagreements and conflicts waste time, energy and resources. Yet many people have difficulty learning how to manage conflict constructively. Herb Kindler is the director of the Centre for Management Effectiveness. Herb, how important is conflict and disagreement in organisations?
Well, it's terribly important in organisations. If people hate to get out of bed to go to work because there's a conflict and bickering and turf wars, it's very disagreeable. And that shows up in morale and low productivity, absenteeism, and so forth.
What are the sorts of things that people actually have conflict and disagreements about? I mean, is it kind of personality clash stuff, or is it more significant organizational issues around resources and so on?
Well, it's certainly both, and often it gets blamed on a personality clash when it's really a deeper seated issue. Issues involving the use of resources, issues on who is part of the team, is someone slacking off and someone has to carry an extra load, hurt feelings, you weren't being fair in my performance appraisal, this sort of thing.
Now, does it tend to happen at any level of the organization? Does there tend to be more conflict at the bottom? Do senior managers get into conflict?
At one point, it was the senior manager would speak and everyone would jump and not argue back, and the disagreement got covered up. Now it's a much more enlightened, I believe, environment out there with thinner ranks of management. And people are expected to, with being empowered, it means that you have to deal with disagreements and resolve them at all levels.
So are you saying that with the new organizational structures, there is actually a greater potential for conflict?
The potential has always been there, but it comes out in the open now. It gets dealt with. It doesn't get swept under a carpet.
Are you aware of any research or of any work that has attempted to actually kind of cost out? How much does conflict cost organizations?
I don't think that there are quantitative studies. I haven't seen them, but certainly just word of mouth, the cost in terms of poor morale, in terms of not getting real commitment from your people. These are very real costs and very difficult to quantify.
Okay, now Herb, you've actually, from your research, identified a number of ways of dealing with conflict constructively. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little about your research.
Well, in fact, the research was a major interviewing project in for-profit, non-profit, and government agencies, in which I interviewed people and who were identified as good conflict handlers. And two threads came through those interviews. One is I asked them, how do you prepare when you expect a conflict? And the answers were, well, I decide how firm or flexible I want to be, which was news to me. I hadn't thought of doing that myself. And then how engaged or distant do I want to be in handling this conflict?
Okay, so in other words, they actually prepare and they think beforehand of how they're going to deal with it. What about, though, conflict that kind of just happens that you don't anticipate, where you can't do that preparation? How do people who handle conflict well, what do they do when it just springs up on them?
Well, conflict management is a lifetime of trying to gain mastery. And the more they are aware and consciously practice it, when those sudden moments come up, they're really prepared from past experience. And sometimes it just blows up and you say, God, I wish I had done something differently.
Okay, so you learn from mistakes, obviously.
Sure.
Okay, well, what are some specific strategies for dealing with conflict which tend to work well?
Well, what happened was, after getting these two threads, I then went through all the literature of psychology, political science, management, negotiation, and came up with 9 different ways, and it fit on a grid using these two dimensions, how flexible and how engaged. Okay. And from that, let's take the firm. There are 3 in the firm, 3 moderately, 3 flexible. In the firm, there is maintaining, smoothing, and dominating.
So are you saying dominating is one way of managing conflict?
Yes.
How would that work?
Well, and I must say that most organizations are now moving toward collaboration and espousing collaboration rather than command and control, domination. Yet, a lot of time gets wasted by not simply using domination. You have an inexperienced person. All they want to find is, tell me how to get started. And that's all they want to know. And so you say, do this, do that. Come back later if there's an issue and we'll discuss it.
So sometimes if I'm in a conflict with you or a disagreement, it's quite appropriate for you just to say, listen, Peter, do it like this.
Right. Okay. And as you get experience, we can come back and discuss it further. But right now, I'm going to dominate the situation from my experience.
All right. If domination is kind of at one end of the range, what's right down at the other one? What's the opposite?
The opposite would be yielding. That's where you're very flexible, and you would yield. Perhaps you've disagreed with your boss three times. The fourth time, it's a minor issue, and you don't want, Peter, you know, you always disagree. Folks, Peter is the devil's advocate. You know, we can discount his view. Well, you don't want that to happen, so you'll yield on this one and go along, and you'll go along in a wholehearted way. Otherwise, if that person doesn't succeed, you never know whether you were dragging your feet or was just really a poor idea.
Would yielding sometimes work also? I may want to actually fight a little harder for a particular issue, mm-hmm. but it's actually not that important to me.
Yeah.
So I'll kind of yield as a way of, I guess, almost earning some brownie points, which I can cash in on later on. I mean, that's rather manipulative.
Well, it may be appropriate for you to function well in the organization. And so you may just say that this is not the hill I want to die on. It's not that important.
Okay, let's talk about, say, a personality clash. You and I may be members of a team, and there's just something in the chemistry between mm-hmm. us. We just don't get along that well.
Yeah.
Now, which of the nine approaches that you have identified through your research, which would be the most appropriate?
Let's take an example.
Let's say that, you know, there's a personality clash.
Okay, let's take an example. You're a big dominator, I'm a big collaborator, or vice versa. And I recognize you're just going to start rolling over me with my collaborative approach. That's not going to work. So I take the one in between, which is bargaining. And as a dominator, you'll respect me as a tough bargainer. And so we can meet at that point.
Okay. So the idea that collaboration is always the best approach, you're really saying sometimes it's not the best approach.
That's right. In fact, one of the most frequent criticisms I hear of organizations is, we're always in meetings, can't get any work done. And that's because of the collaborative culture is so embedded that people, no matter how unimportant, what color should the carpeting be? Well, let's have a meeting and discuss it.
And we've got to get a consensus.
Right.
Well, that's very interesting. So this idea that we've all got to agree, we've all got to collaborate, we've all got to achieve consensus, you're saying that actually wastes a hell of a lot of time.
It does when you don't pick your targets right. And it's appropriate to collaborate for a couple of reasons. One is you want to, in collaboration, you build relationships. You really get to understand people. You build trust. You develop a culture of openness so you can really deal with issues. And in collaboration, if it's a long-term thing, if it's company policy formulation, yes, collaboration is appropriate.
Okay, let me go back to that example before even the team one where we have a personality clash.
Yeah.
Now, let's say I'm not a dominator. Let's say I'm an avoider.
Okay.
And you maybe still are a collaborator. Let's go with that scenario. But I'm an avoider. So you try and engage me in a discussion. I kind of don't want to know about it.
Mm-hmm.
What's the best way for you to deal with the situation then?
Let's look underneath your question, which is that you're suggesting that strategies are equated to personality styles.
Yeah.
And I'm suggesting that's wrong. And we can have a disagreement on that. All these strategies are behaviors. They all can be learned. And the idea is to have a repertoire, so you have 9 different strategies, like having 9 golf clubs. You get into a sand trap, you don't take out a 2-wood. You can take out the appropriate club.
Would you agree, though, that some people would have a kind of natural tendency to certain behavioral styles?
I suppose if you have a high level of testosterone.
Yeah, or, you know, I didn't get my potty training right, or whatever it is.
Yes.
I mean, let's say, I understand what you're saying, and I agree with you about the 9 side, but let's say I have a tendency to want to avoid. That's just my personality. Mm-hmm. I haven't been on Herb Kindler's course to learn the 9 styles yet, or watch the video.
Okay.
So I tend to... What would be the best behavioral strategy for you to use in that situation?
What I would say is avoiding, I prefer the word maintaining the status quo, is appropriate. Now let's look at where it's appropriate. It's appropriate where we table something, but we don't have enough information. A customer calls and says, I'm going to sue your company for blah, blah, blah. I'm going to avoid getting into a conflict at that point. So I'm willing to show the person that, yes, this avoidance behavior or maintaining behavior is appropriate at certain times, and at other times it isn't.
Okay. So really your idea is, here are 9 golf clubs, if you will, to use that analogy, and the idea is to really have, I guess, 2 skills. One is the ability to work out which is the right one in which situation.
Right.
And then secondly, tell me if I'm right, the kind of flexibility to be able to deliver that one at the right time.
Right, exactly. And there's some skill building involved, and some particularly interpersonal skills. Collaboration, we say, oh yeah, let's collaborate. Well, you can't just collaborate if, for example, I think of you as, Peter, we're having this discussion, and your question seemed terribly inane. I'm just saying this mentally to myself.
I know, it's hypothetical.
Right, hypothetical. What a turkey. Sure. And you're saying, Herb, my God, what, this guy is an idiot. What what responses to these intelligent... We're not going to be able to collaborate. So collaboration involves mutual trust, mutual respect, and some interpersonal communication skills.
Where do people get these skills?
Well, they get them in training program. Funny you should ask.
Okay. Is there anywhere else? I mean, apart from
the
obvious of training programs, I mean, you know,
yes.
Mentoring, is it a matter of finding people who are good and watching them?
You can certainly do it through modeling. You also can do it by taking low-risk types of chances. For instance, I'm low at dominating, let's say. Okay, I'll practice in the hotel says you have to check out by 1. I'm going to get them to agree to check out by 3.
Okay. So in other words, planning fairly low risk opportunities to experiment and
right.
try out.
Bargaining. Okay. I'm a terrible bargainer. Okay, I'm going to practice at the department store where they say the refrigerator costs so much, and see if I can get them to knock off some dollars.
Finally, Herb, out of the 9 styles that you have identified, which one is, if I had to ask you to identify one which you think most managers and team leaders and organizations need to develop more of, which would it be?
Oh, dear. That's a tricky question, because it's this matching that you talked about, is having the skill to deliver. And it's like asking me which one of your children do you love best.
Okay. So really it's a matter of developing a repertoire and having a range.
Exactly.
And developing that flexibility.
Exactly.
Herb Kindler, thank you very much for joining me.
My pleasure.